this afternoon, and I hope we'll have some interesting conversation. With me this afternoon, we have, from my far right, we have Chief Josephine Ekiru. I think you've read about her. Chief Josephine Ekiru actually is our chief in Lokichar, and she'll be bringing perspective from the ground. We have also Beta Hadley with the CEO. I think you're standing in for Beta, right? For him. Sorry. We have Beta here. Then we have Susan and Joseph. I didn't get your name right. Geoffrey Kerosi. So let's appreciate them once more before we proceed to the task ahead of us. So we'll this afternoon be understanding the community perspectives and what they understand by EHS. And this panel here will be helping me do this task. So I'll invite you to work with us. Before I proceed, I will just like to create an understanding from and get this from my panelists just today. And I think I'll start from my friend Joseph. Joseph works for Trochia, and I think he is coming from Turkana. And the first question I want to ask Joseph, do you think the communities, from in Turkana, where I think we have the best story when talking about oil, and I think in earlier forums we've also got perspectives around EHS. Do you think the communities in Turkana understand what EHS is all about?
Thank you very much, Bernice. When we talk about the EHS, and from the presentations we've had yesterday, and from a community perspective, I think they do not understand what EHS is. Why? Because one, EHS is a company-led process that is within the confines of the four walls of the company, and it is not mostly practiced outside. For instance, we find occupational safety experts are here, they tell us they deal with assets, risks to both staff and other people, but rarely we find those discourses outside the people who are not working for the companies. So from a community perspective, EHS may not be something of concern to them, or they may not even be aware whether EHS is there or not, because it is normally inside there. But the EHS from a community perspective, for me, I really not talk about safety per se, but I talk about security. Because security is a matter of concern and it has aspects of safety. But again, that is not something the companies can provide. Even within the EHS, they don't talk about security, they talk about safety. But on the community side, it's about security.
Well, that's very interesting, because I think in the earlier forums, as someone asked from the audience, and this question was put to Talo in terms of what mechanisms have they put in place for their trucks that are moving. So for me, I didn't see it from a community perspective coming from security. I saw it in terms of what other risks are they exposed to. So are you saying that this is only limited to security and they're not worried about any other things? Even away from the transport, do their operations carry other risks? They may not really be able to define EHS the way we understand it, but what are some of the issues, or what do they allude to as EHS? And I think that would be interesting for us.
I think it's an interesting question. The interface between communities and the EHS, especially the safety risks, let's say transport. We've had trucks run off on roads. We've had community marshals. We've had people who have not had accepted compensation, because culturally, if somebody is knocked and has died, if you compensate in terms of monetary value, for them they think it's not enough, and then they think compensation should come in terms of goods. So in terms of safety and security on communities, I think there is an interface between the risks associated with the transport sector, and I think the industry players have done good, and you can attest to this, in terms of even the risks of the accidents that are produced for, because of the measures, especially the steel units, and the fact that there is, you know?
Yeah, so I think that's very, very useful. I don't know, Susan, I think you guys are working in Block L14 and L4, or L13. Yeah, you could bring us perspective from the coast. So we see with the communities there, or and maybe as the nearest communities to where your operations are, or the, your stakeholders, do they really understand that what you call EHS?
Oh, thank you so much. So for us, I'd say we've come a long way as from when we started getting busy sometime late last year, because the community didn't understand it well. And for us, for community, I'll start with like the local guards. Our guards are they're people from Pate Island. So basically, we tried making them understand what EHS is all about. And we've started from like the basics of things that they can even practice in their own homes, like training them on a few basics about first aid. Then now, slowly, we started training the ones who are helping on the well site construction and around the roads and all that. Now bringing them to understand about their own safety, like how they should protect themselves or how they can ensure they work in a safe manner. So it's still work in progress for us.
Fantastic. So my panelists, I think, are creating the mood for us in terms of discussing, and I'll be mixing the languages. I'll be moving from Kiswahili, and I'll try a bit of Spanish. So I think because of the diversity in our audience, we have people from Spain. So it's very interesting what Joseph has shared in terms of that concept of EHS, bringing in the issue of security and also touching on safety, and also what Susan said. And I think I'll ask Bessel, I think as someone who works with the civil society, and they've been very vocal in terms of the community being involved. You think the communities are having this understanding, and what are some of the gaps that you think exist that you've been trying to advocate that the people like Talo, people like Sepsa, people like Zarara, who will try to fit in terms of helping these communities know that we have this risk and this is the mechanisms that are being put in place to mitigate this issue. So that is the whole conversation around EHS. What is your perspective about that? Just welcome.
All right. From the perspective of communities, they do understand the consequences of the upstream activities on the environment and on their social well-being that much. They do understand it. And I give an example of the fisher folk in Kilifi, Mombasa, and Kwale. They do understand that if there is an oil spill, and there have been one in Kilifi, which affected the mangroves, and the mangroves are the habitat for the fish, and that fish, when it is lost, then the livelihoods and their income goes down. So they do understand the relationship between the oil spill for the environment and their income and livelihood. They do understand that. But the problem or the gaps come in terms of if there is that kind of oil spill, what measures, practical measures can be taken, you know, to clean up that environment or to get a compensation. Okay, and there was an oil spill at one time, and when issues of compensation started arising, you know, the communities were informed that because they were not organized at that time as a beach management units, they do not have a collective action institution for that compensation to be done. And therefore, the beneficiary of that compensation, it is going to be the State Department of Fisheries, because it's in charge of fisheries, and then the forest, Kenya Forest Service, because they're in charge of, you know, the mangroves. And to me, that is not fair, because the communities, they're the one who depend on the mangroves and the fish. So if you give compensation to the government bodies, then what happens now in terms of the general gaps, especially on the environmental health and safety, that systems, they're the ones that are a little bit not in place. Because I've given an example in the morning that, you know, the Kenya Maritime Authority and some other stakeholders, Kenya Ports Authority, some private sector in Mombasa, they have come up with, you know, a contingency kind of, you know, rapid response team, and they involve the members of the communities, all right? But the members of communities, they are only involved in terms of, you know, some little training, and but in terms of the whole game plan, from the planning bit up to the result chain, you know, they are not, I do not include the tip of that matter. That's why I'm saying it will be important for them to know the entire process and their roles and responsibility. And we have a few examples in the coast when it comes to issues of rescue, in terms of safety issues. We have, you know, communities in Kilifi, Malindi, and some members who are here, they are part of those rescue, you know, teams. So there's a bit of knowledge, but in terms of the systems and the structures from both the companies and the government, in terms of doing that, I think it's where we are lacking.
Thank you very much. I think that's very useful. And being that ameongelelea kuhusu vile mambo inaelekea kule pwani katika mambo ya EHS, ameongelea jambo la kwanza ambayo amesema ni kwamba zile kuna zile kamati maalum ambao ama zile coalitions ambazo zinaweza kuja pamoja ili kuendeleza mambo ya jamii kuliko kuhusiana na mambo ya EHS. Na amesema kwamba hizi coalitions ama hizi groups zinapatia community nguvu ya kuongea kwa pamoja. Kama kuna mahali ambapo mambo ya EHS haijaenda vizuri, hizi vikundi vinaweza kuchukua kuongea kwa sauti moja na kuchukua kauli moja. Hiyo imekuwa jambo la muhimu sana. Lakini pia jambo lingine ambalo alikuwa ameongelea ni kwamba ana pia Joseph alikuwa ameiguzia, nadhani pia ni muhimu kwamba tunapozungumzia mambo ya watu kufahamika ama ni ile ujuzi ama habari gani ambao wale communities wanajua kulingana na mambo ya EHS, kuna mambo ambayo inajitokeza ya kulipa ridhaa kwa wale ambao wameathiriwa na hizo operations za hizo kampuni kwa mambo ya mafuta. Na ningependa nimkaribishe Chief Josephine ambaye amekuwa logicha tangu mambo ya mafuta yaanze huko, na ningependa nimuulize ni njia gani serikali na kampuni kama Talo kwa mfano Turkana na jamii kama kwa mfano jamii ya Turkana wanaweza fanya kazi haje pamoja ili kuleta maafikiano kwa njia ambazo wanaweza kutatua mambo za EHS katika operation kama hizo. Karibu.
Kwa wale wanjui najua anaitwa Josephine Tweka, natoka Lupita, mali mafuta ilianzishwa. Umuhimu ya serikali na kampuni ama investors ni kukaa chini na kueleza community katika baraza jinsi wanaweza kusaidia kampuni kuwezesha kuchimba mafuta. Kwa mfano, kabla Talo hajaanza kuchimba mafuta, kulikuwa na mikutano ya viongozi. Pia baada ya viongozi, wakaenda katika baraza kubwa ya wananchi ya community yote kueleza ya kwamba Talo wamepewa license kutafuta mafuta. Baada ya Talo kupeana habari kwa wananchi, wananchi walikubali. Na hapo wakaanza kufanya survey. Wananchi walielezwa ya kwamba kutakuwa na survey. Ya kwanza itakuwa ni ndege, itakuwa juu ikisafiri laini ya mafuta. Ya pili wakaelezwa kwamba kuna magari kubwa kubwa ambayo itaenda na malaini. Makampuni kama Global, BGP walipewa contract kufanya hizo safiri. Hapo wananchi walielezwa. Lakini hawakueleza madhara ambaye itatokea. Lakini walielezwa ya kwamba kutakuwa na safiri ya ndege na magari. Baada ya hiyo ikapatikana mashimo ya chimba mafuta. Mali site imechimbwa mafuta sasa. Ile community mali pale ambaye mafuta itapatikana kwa area yao, walielezwa kwamba hakuna madhara. Lakini department ya neema hakuonekana, ni Talo tu na wananchi na wafanyikazi wa serikali. Niposa wananchi wakati huu wanauliza ile madhara imeingia katika sehemu hii. Kwa nini ma department sectors ambaye leo jana nilikuwa na naona wanatoa ripoti nzuri hawakukuwa mali pale siku ambaye mafuta ilianzishwa. Na mimi kama Mturkana na mwana Kenya wote wanatakana kuongea kwa sauti moja, hili mambo ya mafuta itengelezwe, ifuate sheria na malengo na kuchunga mazingira na afya ya watu. Kwa hivyo yale ningesema kwamba NGOs kama wale wametuleta mahali hapa ni mzuri kwa sababu wameleta watu kutoka mbalimbali, ili wale wajafikiwa kuchimba mafuta yao watapata knowledge kutoka mahali imeanzishwa mafuta na mahali haijaanzishwa. Kwa hivyo mahali ambayo tulienda nje, mahali tulitembea mbaya, tunatakana turekebishe. Hasa risk, wale watu wanahusika mambo ya risk, wale wanahusika na mambo ya FIFA, wale wafanyikazi wanatureinua huko ndani. Faeni boots, faeni skinny element, faa kitu ingine hapa. Lakini mwananchi wa wale chini, karibu na vizima, hawakufunzwa. Wale COOs ambaye wanakuja katika vijiji, wanafunza mambo ya stages, stage 1, stage 2, paka saizi, usafirishaji ya mafuta, hawakueleza wakisafirisha mafuta, nini itatokea. Barabarani, tutaweka wakina nani wachunge mafuta. Leo nimesikia ya kwamba kuna makampuni special ambayo watapata matrack, hawajaeleza wananchi. Kwa hivyo hiyo ndio nimesema na bado nitasema.
Makofi mzuri, makofi mzuri, si makofi ya wewe. Asante sana Josephine, nadhani ameeleza kwa uwazi kabisa na kwa mapana tangu operesheni zianze pale Turkana hadi siku ya leo. Ndugu yetu Geoffrey kutoka kijamii, labda utueleze kwamba katika kazi yenu, najua mnaguzia sana mambo ya haki za jamii, na haki kati ya hizi haki ni kupata habari. Mmekabiliana na mambo kama hiyo katika jamii ambazo mmekuwa mkifanya nao kazi, wakiuliza kwamba ni haki yetu kupata habari kama hizo za EHS kwa nikitilia manani EHS. Umekabiliana na mambo kama hayo?
Asante sana kwa na Dennis. Sisi hatufanyi kazi katika mambo ya oil and gas, lakini tunafanya kwa mambo ya mining, and I believe mining and oil and gas are in the same sector, these extractives. So you will allow me to share from the area where I know most than talking about oil and gas. So sisi tumekuwa tukifanya kazi huko Kwale katika kampuni, karibu na kampuni ambayo inaitwa Best Titanium Limited, ambayo inafanya mining of titanium, they are referred as minerals, ambazo wana mining huko Kwale. Kwa hivyo access to information in relation to environmental health and safety at the beginning haikuwa wazi. Wananchi hawakuwa na hata zile environmental impact assessment reports, hawakuwa wanajua ni nini iko ndani ya hizo reports. Na baadaye wakati tulipata hizo reports, kuna wale ambao walikuwa wanasema ya kwamba those reports ni kama ziko copy-pasted from elsewhere. So those concerns have been raised. I'm not the origin of those. But then the people from around Base Titanium, there are several villages, around 9 of them, including Uruku, Witi, those were the original villages from which people were displaced for mining. Wale watu, kwa sababu ile kampuni na zile kampuni ambazo zilitangulia zimekuwa pale kwa miaka mingi, wamefunzwa na wamejifunza yale madhara ambayo yanatokana na issues of mining. Kwa hivyo nitataja tu kwa ufupi yale ambayo tumeangazia pale. Tumeona kwamba wananchi wanaelewa kwamba in terms of environmental there are those negative impacts on the people around the mining area. Kwa mfano kuna issues of noise pollution. Kuna wale watu ambao walibaki karibu na mine kabisa, they are next to the mine. Wale watu wanasema ya kwamba the machines which are being used for mining they produce a lot of noise. So which is an environmental concern for them. Then there is another issue of dust. Because you know they are producing minerals, so they mine the upper layer of the soil which they use to extract minerals. So there is dust. There is also issues of you know the kind of mining they are doing there, they use plenty of water. So wamejenga dam ambayo inaitwa, I don't know if I will pronounce it correctly, inaitwa Ngurumudusi. Someone from coast can help me in pronouncing that one later. Gurumusi. Yes, that one. That dam, the dam was built to provide water for the use in the mining area. Because they use lots of water to extract minerals. They mix the water with the soil and other components from the earth. Then they pump that from the field to the processing area. So people say that there are effects out of that. They say they use chemicals which has not been proven, and they make claims, meaning that they are aware of the impacts of that mining processes. Because they say there are some claims they have made, but we have also worked directly with the Best Titanium Limited, who have said that is not true. For them, they say they do not use any chemicals to extract the minerals. But then the people do understand. On the earth side,
how do you summarize also?
Yes. In terms of health, the people around the mining area do not cultivate any food stuff because initially that area was a forest. There is a forest nearby actually called Simba Hills. So there is wild animals. When people moved, the few who remained now cannot be able to cultivate because the wild animals, they roam around at night, including pythons, crocodiles, and others. So you see, if we don't have food, there is the issue of malnutrition. which they raised land again. And then the government has neglected these people around the mining area, because they say, what about our base? That is what they tell me. So there's a lot of effects as well, so understand what's going on.
That's very useful. And I think, amelezea vizuri sana zile mambo ambayo yale jamii ambayo anaishi hapo karibu na hiyo operation za best titanium, zile mambo ambazo wana inawatia shauku sana kulingana na mambo ya EHS. Na ningependa sasa kuwauliza swali wale ambao wame ningeomba wale kuna microphones. Kuna microphones kwa audience. Sio amuulize swali kwa hii afternoon. Hii afternoon imebadilika. Mimi ndo nauliza maswali. Swali ambayo ningetaka kuuliza ni kwamba ni nani ambaye anatakana kuchukua jukumu kubwa ya kuhamasisha jamii kwa mambo ya EHS? Hiyo ndio swali nataka kuuliza. Na tuko na microphone upande. Ziko ngapi? Yeah, nani anaweza kusaidia kuelewa hiyo katika kutoka kwa wenye wameketi upande huo mwingine?
Neema.
Ni Neema.
Habari ya kushinda.
Nzuri sana.
Kuna swali nimuulize mining, lakini
tunafika hapo ndugu yangu.
Ndio, ndio. Mtu ambaye anaweza kuhamasisha jamii ni county government. Pale mradi ambako huko.
Ni county government.
Ndio.
Sasa tumesikia ni Neema natakana ya masisha jamii, tumesikia county government. Nani mwingine anataka kujaribu? Hiyo meza ndio inakaa iko na watu wazito.
Jambo.
I believe that the county government has a role to play. The civil society has a role to play. And any other person who is knowledgeable about EHS can also play a role.
Yeye amesema hao washikadau wote wako na nafasi ya kufanya katika kuhamasisha jamii kuhusu mambo ya EHS. Karibu tu niongee Spanish nikiongeza accent.
Mimi nitasema yeyote yule katika wao hao wametajika, hiyo chain yote, yule ambaye anawiana na jamii zaidi ni nani? Yule ambaye anawiana ama anaoana sikuwa na kidoa inuluga ni nani katika ni nani katika hao civil society, NEMA, county government? Yule yoyote ambaye anawiana ama anaoana na jamii kwa karibu ndiye anafaa kupeleka huo hayo masomo.
Sasa umesema kuna uwiano,
uoano,
hizo zote. Ameelezea vizuri sana. Amesema lazima kukuwe na uwiano ama understanding ama wale ambao wako karibu sana na jamii. Sijui mnafikiriaje, lakini kabla tuendelee, ningependa kuuliza Susan kama ambaye mko hapa na amefanya operesheni. Nadhani katika hii panel ni papa yeye ndiye anaendesha operesheni. Ningependa kumuuliza ni wakati gani, labda si zarara, lakini kampuni yote, ni wakati gani mwafaka ambayo inatakana mwanze kuhamasisha jamii mambo ya EHS? Ni wakati gani katika project?
Kulingana na vile ambavyo unaelewa ni kwamba pale ambapo kabla mradi uanze ni muhimu kuhamasisha jamii kuhusu mambo ya EHS. Alafu pia ninavyoelewa ni kwamba kuna various stages yani of the whole project cycle, right? Kwa hivyo yani pale ambapo mko yani mkitoka kiwango kimoja mnakwenda kwa kingine, maybe before it would be advisable muhamasishe jamii so that they know that sorry I'm mixing both English and Swahili, but ndio waweze kuelewa kwamba before you get into the operations, these are the risks and this is what you're putting in place to minimize the risk or mitigate them, so that isiwe kwamba you just go and do whatever stage you're in of your project, and then when the risks are now affecting the locals, that's when you come out and you're like, this is what and what we had tried doing. Definitely the community will not understand, unlike if you had informed them before. So the approach I feel is best is informing them prior to whatever stage you're about to engage in.
Bila bado nitaongezea mambo ya masuala ya mazingira, afya na masuala ya jamii yanatakana yaanze wakati wa tathmini ya mazingira. Manake wakati wa tathmini ya mazingira, tathmini ya athari za mazingira ama EIA, pale ndio maswala yote ya EHS yatajitokeza na kufafanuliwa. Lakini tunaona kwamba tathmini hizi huwa zinafanywa kwa njia ambazo si za sawa na taarifa haiwafikii jamii. Sasa hapo ndio tunaanzia kukosea. Kwa hivyo tunasema tu maswala haya si swala la siku moja ama kipengele kimoja, one step. Inatakana from the beginning of the planning, the design, throughout the implementation, alafu wakati mnafanya monitoring and evaluation. Lakini kwa sababu tuliambiwa EHS sio mambo ya profit, ni kutumia tu pesa, mara nyingi inaekwa nyuma huko. Kwa sababu wahusika wataki kutumia fedha zao, wanapunguza faida yao.
Asante sana. So, nadhani Susan na wanandezi pete wanaelezea vizuri sana kwamba kwa maoni yao wanafikiria kwamba wakati ule mzuri ama mwafaka kuzungumza mambo ya EHS kwa jamii, kwanza wamesema ni wakati wa tathmini na pia wakati ambapo mradi huo unaendelea. Jamii inatakana kuhamasishwa wakati huo wote. Nadhani hiyo ni muhimu sana kwa katika mjadala wa leo, kwamba tunaweza kuangazia project yote kwa ujumla kuanzia mwanzo na hapa tunapoendelea hadi mwisho. Ningependa kualika hivi sasa ili muweze kuchangia mjadala huu, kuuliza maswali. Tuko na panelists hapa ambao wanaendesha operation, ambao wanafanya katika civil society, ambao wanafanya na serikali, na uzoefu wa kutosha ili kujibu swali. Kuna mtu amekaa huko kwa giza, naona tu shati nyeupe, lakini nadhani kuna mtu hapo. Mpatie microphone. Karibu ndugu yangu, uliza maswali.
Thank you. Nafikiri nikicheka kidogo unaweza kuona meno ndio.
Asante na naweza kuona.
No, my question is very simple. Where is the place of honesty in the process of community engagement in the whole process? Because that is key in getting information, getting people involved. The expertise that is seated up there could mention something about honesty in providing information and participation. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'll take another question from my brother on the left.
Nyokonji, nitaongea Kiswahili. Mama wetu umeongea vizuri sana, Chief. And it's not by mistake that wewe ulikuweko wakati ule wa kwanza ile mzunga naitaka feasibility studies mpaka saizi. In fact, wewe una a wealth of information as regards hii mambo ya mafuta ya Turkana. And na kuombea tu ukae hivyo, ushakamu kwa interview sisi watu wa Union of Concerned Scientists tujue itakuwa namna gani. Sasa swali ni tumesikia kwa magazeti na maredio na ma-TV shida, apart from hii shida ya mgawa wa mapato, tumekuwa na shida ya watoto wetu, wajukuu wangu kule chini wanadharauliwa hawapatiwi kazi. Ndege inatoka hapa Nairobi imebeba watu Waluhya, Wajaluo, Kikuyu, wanapelekwa huko kwenda kuandikwa kazi. Mimi sichochei mtu, mimi ni Mkenya, hata wale wanapelekwa huko ni wa Kenya, but ni vizuri wewe kama mama uwezi kupatia watoto wengine chakula na ukuaje wako wapatie last, patia wako kwanza, sijue hivyo. Hebu tuambie wewe kama mama utatatua namna gani hiyo tatizo la wafanyikazi. Waache mambo ya masomo, masomo tu ni makaratasi tu, tunaona nyingi zinapitapita hapa. Mpatie Mturukana, umwambie hii inafanywa hivi na hivi na hivi, after 1 year atakuwa amejua kuendesha hiyo mashini, sijue hivyo. Nataka utuambie mama hiyo issue itaitatua.
Asante sana, asante sana. Swali la mwisho kabla ni alike panelist wajibu maswali.
Baada ya kushinda.
Lakini kabla hujauliza swali,
toa jina.
Nipo tutaka moja. Ndugu yangu ulisema sikupata jina lakini unatoka katika union ya concerned scientists.
Wapo na headquarters yao UK.
Aha.
Na panga mkutano hapa mkubwa kabisa ilole.
Sawa sawa. Ningeruhusu tu katika mjadala wa leo. Kwa sababu umezungumzia mambo muhimu sana, kupatia nafasi wale watu ambao kutoka Turkana katika kufanya kazi katika hizo operesheni. Lakini Daktari Melba, umesikia hiyo, kuna mambo nitakana kutengeneza kongamano ingine kama hii ambayo tutazungumzia mambo ya ajira na nafasi za kazi na nafasi za biashara. Kwa leo nitaomba tu kwa sababu ya wakati tusiguzie sana mambo ya employment, lakini kwa wakati mwafaka Chief Josephine ataelezea tu kwa ufupi, lakini nadhani tutakuwa na mjadala wa kuendelea. Endelea ndugu yangu.
Habari ya kushinda.
Nzuri.
Majina kamili naitwa Mtambi Kai, natoka Kwale, sehemu ambayo karibu na maini. Maswali yangu ni mawili kuhusiana na afya na mazingira kama maini. Umesema kuwa kwamba wasikia aliye una hatihati kuna hakika. Kule kiafya na mama kwa wakati huu wakishika mimba, mimba zinatoka. Wale ambao karibu na mtambo. Wale ambao kwenye mtambo wanakunywa maji, kujua wanakunywa damu. Hilo ni tatizo ambalo liko. Na sijui kwa utaratibu mwingine kutoka kwa base mpaka kufika Mombasa ni kilomita 100. Na kuna wale malori ambayo yanatembea yanabeba vile vifaa au maji, yani mchanga huu kutoka Mombasa mpaka huko sehemu nyingine ambapo natoka maini. Ni hatua gani ambayo imechukuliwa ya kuweza kudhibiti ile hali? Kimazingira, maji machafu yanaenda kwa mangroves. Kule mangroves ni sehemu ambazo ni mazalia ya samaki, wavuvi pia wanapata tabu kwa wakati huu. Je, ni hatua gani kama wewe ni afisa wa mazingira kulingana na maini?
Kuna mining umepata hiyo taarifa. Kuna mtu na watu wameuliza maswali hapa. Nadhani nachukua hizi 3-4 alafu tutafunga session. Naruhusu washikadau kwa hiyo meza tusaidie dada yetu kwanza kauliza maswali alafu tutakuja kwa hiyo meza na kama imejaa na wazito.
Majina yangu ni Veronica Mwende kutoka Mwibeze ama Mwibe Champion. Swali langu ni je, tunasikia kabla ya amani nianze, lazima neno wapeane license. Na kila mahali kunafanywa mining, Kenya way, tunasikia madhara kwa community. Mpaka hapo, ni njia gani, ni hatua gani, kama neema, wamechukua kufuatilia mining ikiendelea. Bila kupeana license na inaondoka. Ni njia gani ni mikakati gani imeweka kuangalia investor kama anatimiza zile ahadi alipeana za litigation ama mnaachia tu hivyo?
Asante sana. Niko na upungufu kidogo lakini tutajibu hiyo swali. Hii panel yetu haijakuwa na mtu wa neema lakini tuko na watu ambao wanafahamu. Watu wa neema pia wapo watatusaidia. Tuelekee kwa hiyo meza. Nadhani tutaongea kwa hiyo meza. Tuenda tu hivyo kwa hiyo ratiba ile mmeketi.
Ni mwaniki Julius kutoka Mui Basin, Core Basin. Yangu kwanza ni kuwashukuru the Extractive Policy Dialogue Forum, Round 3. Na nilikuwa ninaomba tutafutue Round 4. Na this time, yongezue petroleum and coal mining. Because today we are talking of gas and oil, na tunasikia disaster ya coal, na inaleta maradha. Huko kwetu haijaanza, lakini we hear about renewable energy, wengine wanafunga makampuni ngambo. So we like this forum, kwa sababu watu wote wako hapa, najua ikiongezewa number 4, iwe na coal mining, mtatusaidia huko. Kwa sababu sasa, ukiona mwenzako ananyolewa, kwa sababu tunaongea petrol today, najua tutaenda kwa coal. Thank you.
Makofi kwake kwa pendekezo hiyo. Pigeni makofi mzuri, si makofi ya wote. Asante sana wale ambao wametengeneza hii kongamano, wamesikia hiyo pendekezo muhimu sana, kwamba walete washikadau pia kutoka huko kwa coal waeleze maelezo hapa. Sawa sawa. Asante sana. Karibu ndugu yangu.
Asante sana. My question is on health. Especially the community perspective. Most of the people, I work in the health department, Turkana, most of the concerns include health. Not what we are discussing about the occupational safety. So my question is, health is one of the developed functions. And I am aware that Tulo is here to do the health impact assessment till now. I think they are planning to do it. So in that aspect, my concern is on the issue of capacity of the local institutions, especially health and any other departments, the county government, to handle the risks, whether disasters or any other future risks, because we are talking about a lot of exposures. And to keep up, what are the capacity building mechanisms that you put in place, now that that's part of your function, to actually help these institutions to be able to handle that right now, especially for the community? Yes.
Asante sana daktari. Kuna mwisho hapo. Kuna mwisho jamuona. Sorry. Sikuwa nimekuona. Nisameni uye radhi. Alafu tutamalizia kwa ndugu yangu kwa sababu muda unayoyoma.
Kwa majina naitwa Halima Sharif from Kajiado County. Na myself, I'm a person with disability, and I request all the stakeholders, please, whenever you have your capacity building, public participation, please, involve people with disability, because they are always left behind, and I think with the environmental health, we are the ones in very big danger. Because most of us, we don't have hearing, blind, and person with physical disability. That's the only request I ask the first partners of this forum, and even the community leaders who are here in all counties and whenever you have your public participation, whenever you have your forums, please include us as part and parcel in the programs.
Yeah, shukran. Makofi kwake. Nafurahia sana kwa sababu katika hii kongamano pia tunapata pia mchango katika kuimarisha kongamano kama hili. Asante sana dadetu. Na nadhani wale wa Extractive Baraza na washikadau wengine wamepata ujumbe huo. Mwisho namalizia kwa ndugu yangu.
Thank you.
Namwambia na niwepia hapa, lakini endelea kumalizia kwa huyo.
Thank you. Amjambo yote. Jina zangu ni Joshua Adi kwa Kaseu County. Sasa swali moja nitakwenda kuuliza, lakini kwanza nataka kuongea juu ya vile tumediscuss hapa. Kutoka swali jambo sio kizuri sana.
Ndiye kwa lugha yote tuna
translator.
So
what I would like to emphasize on is from the experience of Nigeria in the oil industry. Now here in Kenya we have Turkana. It is still early, we can do what we call damage control. So I would just ask Madam Chief, because sababu hatuwezi kusubiri watu wa neema kuja kutuelezea ile tutafanya pale Lodwa. Hata sasa hawako, nisikia hapo, they are not there. Kwa hivyo wewe kama kiongozi katika jamii, mimi ninasisitiza kwamba ungefanya mchango ya kuhamasisha Waturkana wale wanaishi pale waweze kujua madhara na hatari ya hiyo mafuta iko hapo, sababu ukiangalia kwa undani zaidi upande wa health, hiyo tumeongea sana hapa tangu asubuhi, utaona ya kwamba hata wale watakuwa wakifanya kazi katika hizo sehemu za mafuta pia watakuwa na hiyo shida. Number one, tumesikia hapo, you eat what you eat is what you breathe. So utapata kwamba hata wale ambao wako wanaishi karibu watakuwa mostly, majority watakuwa affected. Na tukiangalia population ya Turkana sio wengi. So tell me, baada ya miaka tatu wale wana wakazi wanakuwa affected, do we expect that population to be rising or going down? Itakuwa inapungua, shauri ya madhara, wengi watakuwa na magonjwa. So ni vizuri wale wana hiyo, those who have that knowledge should pass it to others, wazee na Madam Chief, badala tungoje neema, wacha neema wache wapate umefika mahali fulani, then they pick up from there. That is my suggestion. Thank you.
Shukrani. Makofi kwake. Hapana mbili makofi mzuri. Asante sana. So, kwa sababu ya wakati, ndugu yangu utanisamea. Sababu naona mkubwa wangu pia ameshasimama kanda. Ningependa tu nipatie, nipitie kwa haraka sana zile maswali. Nikipatia panel wetu nafasi moja moja wakiendelea. Microphone ikipiga huko mwisho itarudi kwa Dr. Melba, alafu itarudi nikae huko chini. Sawa sawa. Mwenipatia hiyo ruhusa. Tuko pamoja? Tuko pamoja? Nikisema tuko pamoja, mnasema pamoja. Tuko pamoja? Pamoja. Asante sana. So, kumekuwa na maswali kadhaa. Na pia mchango kutoka kwa wenzetu ambao kwa upande mwingine. Swali ambayo pendekezo ambazo zimekuja, ya kwanza ni kwamba kuhamana ambazo zinakuja waweke coal mining, hiyo wamesikia. Pendekezo lingine ambayo limekuja ni kwamba wale people living with disability wamejumuisha katika mpangilio katika kongamano kama hizi. Hiyo pia nadhani imechukuliwa vizuri. Pendekezo lingine ambayo limekuja ni kwamba kwa ile ambayo chief alikuwa ameshare na sisi ni kwamba aendelee kuhamasisha jamii, tukingoja washikadau wengine wakuje. Swali ambayo lilizwa na daktari kwamba ni njia zipi ama mikakati zipi ambazo zimewekwa ili kusaidia jamii ama zile institutions ambayo ziko pale kama county government na zingine kudeal na zile impacts ambazo zinahusiana na EHS. Panelist wangu mgani atajibu hii swali hiyo? Hiyo Chief Joskin atajibu hiyo kwa ufupi tu.
Atajibu maswali mbili. Ya kwanza, watu gani wameandikwa mahali pale? Mandele inatoka huko? Si vile. Kuna Wakenya kutoka Kenya na kuna Waturkana kutoka Kenya wameajiriwa, na wale watu wametoka nje ya nchi ambayo wako na expert. Huwezi kupeleka Mturkana kushika ile mashine na ajenda masomo hiyo ni kama unaua. Kwa hivyo hata watu gana sasa hivi wamesoma mambo ya mafuta wako wengi sasa. Hii mkondo wa kubeba mafuta hapo ndio kashasha itaja, kwa sababu watu watataka kazi wako na makaratasi. Lakini wakati walianza tuliwachilia, tukasema waje tusome kutoka kwa watu wale wako na makaratasi ya engineer. Na wengi wajaluo wamesoma, tunashukuru. Unaona, ukienda huko wa engineer wengi na ni watu wazuri. Wacha niambie, hata Waturkana wale wajasoma wamejua hata kushika hizo machuma na hajasoma. Kwa hivyo ni mtu anatumia akili ya hekima na ile ya makaratasi. Ya pili, Kenya ni nchi moja na kabila 47. Sisi kama Waturkana hatutaki ukabila. Kazi lazima tuchanganyike. Hatuwezi kufanya ile mambo ya kubagua. Na kama mimi mwenye nasimamia rais huko chini, lazima nifanye kazi transparent and accountability. Kazi ifanywe vizuri na mtu afanye kazi vile inatakana. Mambo ya neema ambayo ningetoa recommendation hapa. Watu wa neema wanatakana wafanye socks vizuri, wafanye kazi yao kwa sababu wamesomea.
Makofi kwako. Kazi kwenu neema. Ndugu yangu Joseph Ekwam, kuna swali hapa iliulizwa kwamba kuna mambo ya honesty. Nimeshindwa kutafsiri hiyo. Lakini nilisikia kuna malenga wamekaa kwa meza moja hapo. Honesty. Watu wanaelezea hii mambo kwa uwazi, kwa ukweli.
Thank you very much. I think what you wanted to put across is transparency, is it?
Pardon?
Instead of honesty, can you allow me to use transparency?
Yani honest?
Yes.
Hata kama ni uchungu kusema kile nimesema.
Okay. My understanding is, from your question, you are saying there is no honesty in these discussions. And my understanding of that is, you are saying there is no transparency. People cannot get to understand what's happening. Because if there is no honesty, things are not clear, people are not understanding what's happening. Is that the question? Mm-hmm. Maybe you can reframe the question there. Okay. Yes. So I will look at this question from an understanding of why there is distrust. For me, I would think maybe there is no transparency, maybe information is not being shared properly, maybe things are not clear, and people don't trust each other. So there are no honest discussions. Maybe that is how we wanted the question to be addressed. But for me, I would look at it from a national discourse, and I will approach it from transparency and accountability perspective. One, it is true that there has not been honesty in the extractive discussions in Kenya. Why? If you ask my Nigerian doctor yesterday, he said, the two people who sit in the room, the industry and the government, they shake their hands. Nobody from us is there, yeah? Mm-hmm. Nobody from the people here was there or is always invited. And so you invite, this, you find out that the secrecy in the PSC, for example, leads to dishonesty from our perspective. Like, why are we not being shown what has been agreed, for example? Mm-hmm. Where is the PSC, for example? And you know, from a legal perspective, there are confidentiality clauses on some of the PSC contracts. You cannot disclose. There is privity of contracts sometimes. But from a community perspective, I think we need to have a honest discussion. We need to be told, for example, let me use a local example. We were told, like, we have agreed. Who said that? It was the government at the local level, which is the county government, and the local leaders. plus the national government. We have agreed we have to start the EOPs. And the communities clapped and said, yes, let's have the EOPs. But the contents of the agreement were not written.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody saw what the agreement was about. People just said, we have agreed, let's move on. And then another discussion came out that if we leave the trucks to go to Mombasa, you will get your 5%. But nobody told the people when to expect the 5%. Now, people are up in arms, closing the camp. They're asking for the 5%.
Yeah.
Are we told when it's coming? No.
Yeah, so I think we will you will answer the question. So it's a good question that you ask about how honest are the discussions. And I think Ekwam has put it so clearly. It depends again who is on the room and all that and which parties are involved. I think our time has run out and we had a fantastic conversation, but I will not end without asking Susan to help us answer the question that was asked by Daktari, and more specifically in terms of how prepared in terms of building capacity of other stakeholders, more particularly the county government and other institutions from a county context in dealing with some of the impacts that are related to EHS and may occur in the course of the projects, or do we handle them as companies or so. After saying that, I think we will call it an afternoon, and I'll be jobless again.
Thank you for that. For me, I believe whatever we decide to do, for as long as it's sustainable, then it works well. For example, for us as Barara, if we don't strike gas, definitely we'll leave. But whatever EHS activities you're putting in place, are they sustainable? So for us, in Lamu, health was one of the major issues. So we are trying to focus on that by improving the local dispensaries and clinics and hospital, and as well as also water is a challenge for them. So we are trying to donate water tanks so that when, in the event that we're not successful, when we leave, at least they can still be able to drop water and try and be sustainable on themselves and just not depend on the organization.
You train?
Yes, we do hold in-house training. That is basically for the locals who are currently working for us so that they can pass this knowledge to their households and people living around them as well. That's the best we're trying to do at the moment. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Susan. Thank you very much, Susan, and my able panel. Please, let's give them a round of applause. And lastly, and very importantly, give me a round of applause. And last but not least, give yourself a round of applause. Then the rest is for Dr. Melba to continue with the program. You may have your seats as we take our juices and popcorns that are waiting for you and arrive on your seat. Thank you very much. It's been great.
Thank you, Dennis. Thank you. Can we agree that Dennis has led a very robust panel?
Yes.
Atujalala, to Lazima School. Thank you, panelists, for sharing those wonderful views, and thank you also for throwing the challenge of the Extractives Baraza kwenda mashinani. It's something we've been talking about, and we really want to do. Tunataka kwenda Kwale, na tunataka kwenda Turkana, kwenda kufanya baraza. As you've seen, the kind of barazas we have are not, they bring everybody to the table. Mazungumzo, honest conversations, now that the word honesty has come up. Honest conversations is what we do. So we are looking for those opportunities, we want to call it EV machinani. So watch this space, hopefully by next year we'll be able to start rolling them out. Now, for the final of the day, how do I introduce this panel? Government has?
Power.
Academia?
Money.
Private sector?
Money.
CSOs?
Right.
to lead us through this conversation, because it's very important that at the end of the day we come to this agreement. Professor Catherine Ngila will be our moderator from Morendat Institute. Makofi tafadhali. So this is the last leg, just before we can go and fight with the traffic. So our session, like which has been introduced, and thank you, of course, to Lemedeket, who is a manager foundation in Kenya Pipeline Company. Bernice is, like I said, is in charge of the foundation, has got wide experience. Thank you very much for taking the seat. Has got wide experience in development field and project conceptualization. The current role that she has right now is to look after communities on behalf of the company, that is Kenya Pipeline Company. The next person is, we have Mr. David Ekiru, who is a Turkana Professional Association chairperson, is it chairperson or secretary general? Is he here? Okay. And so he's a consultant and he deals with, of course he's got skills, consultation skills in oil and gas in Africa under the GIZ, that is the German International Corporation. And he's very much involved with the youth skills development for East Africa in partnership with the Turkana County. Thank you. The third person, that is Mr. Huma Kaseu. You see here, Huma Kaseu, yeah. So Mr. Kaseu, he is an expert in sustainable strategic management. He's got a lot of experience in that particular area. He is, before he was working for Tano some time back, but he has moved on, and now he's a co-founder and a consultant for a company called Tribe 360. Now we're going to hear what that is all about. Oh, what I could tell, it is creativity. He brings creativity in every single corporation. So he's going to tell us more on how that creativity can be translated to the partnership between county government, between the communities, the government, the academia, and anybody else who is in that particular panel. And so we've got the last, no, the fifth, how many do we have there? So we have got, Huma is there, David Ekiru has come, is that correct? Yes. We've got Joel Omondi, yes. Joel Omondi is, he's got skills and experience. He has worked with the World Bank, of course, skills and experience in sustainable finance, international cooperation, worked with projects on funded by World Bank. Thank you very much for taking the seat in front. Policy development, strategic planning, experience in guiding development, best practice, and with a lot of interest in community. So you can see that we are all centered around the communities. Now, the last or the fifth person who was supposed to be with us and couldn't make it is Mr. Benson Ochieng. So he excused himself, that is from the University of Nairobi. And so we have got a replacement for Benson. We've got Dr. John Chumo. Dr. John Chumo. Remember, did you say Dr. Chumo is here, is it?
Yes.
He needed to be. Okay, please come to the front. And so Dr. Chumo is the secretary of the National Environmental Complaints Committee, or NEC. Kind of environmental ombudsman, and that was established under the law, basically environmental management. So because we are talking about environment, health and safety, is going to be very key in terms of translating some of these gray areas. And so my colleagues, so we are going to start, let me move now to the privileged side, which is the platform.
All right. So I will start with. All right. Now starting with the first panelist, according just to the list, the way I read them, we've got Bernice from Kenya Pipeline. And so the issues, Bernice, that we want to ask, and of course everybody will also make a comment, is that are issues to do with being a liaison, not a liaison as such, but kind of the position that you occupy is a liaison one, that between the company that you're working for, which is the foundation, and Kenya Pipeline. So Kenya Pipeline is communication with the communities, because we have got what we call the right of way in Kenya Pipeline. The pipeline passes through communities, and so you are all, as the manager in charge of that foundation, could you just kind of tell us your experience in terms of setting up community engagement, community partnerships, so forth and so on, with regards to sensitizing them in view of the today's topic, which is health, safety, and environment.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Prof. Just to give you a bit of background of the foundation. So, because people kept asking me what is the foundation. So basically, foundation is the arm that is mandated by the company to execute corporate social investment, or what used to be called corporate social responsibility. So in other words, is the philanthropic or the charitable arm of the company. So based on what Prof is asking, we realized that as a company, we needed to have a social license to operate. That we cannot just think about the pipeline without thinking about the people. So we have a relationship with the community where the pipeline passes. So that is our base where we stand. So in terms of our operations, our pipeline affects the people directly because it passes through people's land. So for 40 years as a company, we've not had a department that really deals with the people. So that informed the formation of the foundation. So in a nutshell, that's what we do. So in terms of what we do, our operations are basically, it's like community engagements. So, and then it has a budget. So as a company, we have a moral responsibility to give back socially and in terms of environment. So we give 1% of our budget towards corporate social investment or responsibility, as we wish to call it. So this is given to the communities through you know, community engagement. So we go to the community and we develop a relationship. So we have quarterly community engagement forums where we interact with the community and talk to them about our operations as a company and how we interface. So one of the things that we talk to them about is, like, for example, issues of safety along the pipeline and how can we be co-partners. So from those meetings, we get to understand that they also have needs. We appreciate the fact that as a company, we are not government, as in to our problems. I mean, we, as much as we have a budget, that's what I want to say, it's not our responsibility to entirely take the burden of the community, but we have a responsibility to give back something small. So we ask them to come up with programs that are community driven, and will have a shared value for the company and for the community. So Prof, through that, then we have the role of CSR. We explain to them that development can be interrupted, that this is a pipeline, and anything can happen to you as a community. So from that, we develop interventions that are meaningful to the community. So they send proposals to us as a company, and then we get to fund them based on that.
Thank you very much, Bernice. We can now go to Mr. David Ekiru, just also to, just for him, at least from the point of view of the professional association in Turkana, basically what is what does he see his role as trying to
sort of initiate some of this conversation between the community and the stakeholders, particularly with regard, of course, to the natural resource exploitation in that particular environment.
Thank you very much. Professor Ngila?
Yes.
And thank you for Baraza for inviting me to this forum. I think we've been engaged very well since the first session, the first Baraza. Turkana Professionals Association is an association of members from Turkana community worldwide. It's not specific to Turkana County. We have chapters in various places, including UK, US, Canada, Australia. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that we do is advocacy work, community engagement, community sensitization, civic education on issues that touch on the community, wherever they are. For instance, I'll give an example, the recent issues in Isiolo. We were right in the middle of it, trying to mitigate against the operations that were taking place. Back home, the announcement was made that finally oil has been found in Turkana, we started engaging with the government and with Talo Oil, the IOC. And one of the things that we started engaging about is issues of managing expectation. You know very well, when a resource is found in a place, when a resource is discovered, there's heightened expectation. One of the things that happened, and you may have read in the press, is that women and the elderly and the young people went to the site, Gamia one with jerry cans, saying, we want our oil, our share of the oil. And, you know, we had to deal with that. Amongst us, our professionals, there's some who are in the civil society organizations, like the Natural Resource Hub, other organizations, FORT, and other CBOs. So we deal with community issues, health and safety issues, issues of dumping. We have engaged with NEMA, we've engaged with the national government, we've engaged with the county government, and our role is basically to bring people to discuss how do we deal with these issues now that they have arisen. How do you deal with the issue of the early oil pilot scheme? How do you deal with the, we were involved in the formulation, the discussion and formulation of the petroleum bill and the mining bill. As a matter of fact, I was one of those people who sat in the mining bill from inception up to the time it was enacted. And therefore we have a lot of input as professionals from Turkana into some of these issues. Interface between the professionals and community, yes, we are part of the community and therefore we understand the issues that that are arising. And in a way we explain some of the silent issues that are never explained by anybody. Chief will tell you there are people who go to her at night, oh, this, my child is having diarrhea because the truck passed by and the dust was blown, or because of the water from the borehole that Talo has drilled, or Talo has shipped off the water. We get to engage with behind the scenes with all this organization in trying to resolve the issues with the community and the oil operator. However, what we have not had a lot of impact on is on the government. You know, the government is a government. And initially, when the operation started, we had drafted a terms of engagement, a memorandum to say, these are our rights, these are our responsibilities, this is government responsibility and the rights and the right of and responsibility of the operator. Can we get to a middle ground and agree on how we shall operate within this space. It took the community, the professionals, to call for a meeting of all the leadership, elected leadership and the community leadership, the government and the operator, to sit down and discuss for 3 days in Lodwar, how do we manage expectation, how do we operate in the space that we've been provided by government. What does the license say? And as you know, up to now, Tala Oil, or the government of Kenya, is operating extracting this oil illegally. There is no law. The lawyers in the room will tell us. There is no law anchoring the operations of oil operations. The law that was in place was the 1986 Act, which has been superseded by the current constitution. And therefore, what we are saying as professionals, one of the demands that we put on the table to the presidency and the government is enact a law. Yeah? Even the early oil pilot scheme that is, I just saw a document being circulated in social media that now the operation is has been agreed on between the government and Tala Oil. And we are asking, what is the community in all this? So what we are saying is, put the law in place. Turkanas are people who obey and respect the law.
Thank you very much, David. Of course, hold that thought, because we are going to now, after we go through the everyone, we are now going to invite a participation from the audience, so that you can be able to give us a take on the kind of issues that we are discussing. So we can now call upon Mr. Huma Kaseu also. In light of this very exciting company that you're working for, or should I say you have formed, which is Tribe 360. Please. In relation, of course, with trying to engage the community, the government, everybody on the table.
Thank you very much, Dr. My name is Huma Kaseu, co-founded Tribe 360. And Tribe 360 was built on the knowledge from the backdrop of looking at the value chain of extractives and the relationship therein, we realize that we operate, especially in the country, with fragmented laws. Laws that deal with extractives are in different legislation or acts. Like mining is not the same as geothermal, it's not the same as oil and gas, it's not the same as. So we understood that we don't, as my able colleague said, we don't have a law that encompasses everything else. Then we looked at the relationship that people have, government, the community, and commercial partners, and CSOs, and we realized that all the relationships that are there are transactional. It is give me this, I give you that. If you give me land to do this, I build for you a school, or I'll give you work, or I give you. And that does not encourage, development of an industry in an objective way. The other backdrop, the other reason which inspired us forming this company is our work in Turkana. The experience in Turkana informs the value of human life, because in Turkana and in the communities up north, there's no single person who controls, there's no single gatekeeper. A young boy can stop operations as the same way that the governor or the president can stop operations. So we realize that in an area where every single person has a right to stop or to determine whether operations continue or not, we need to form a framework in which people can operate within. Assure the commercial partners of socialize to operate, secure community rights, and enhance benefits that accrue to the community, which are impacted by dint of the operations being there. That's why we funded this company. And What the company does is we approach, normally a consultant will approach the commercial partner to give them a contract to do community engagement or whatever. For us, our approach is we approach the community and ask the community what their needs are. We understand the community, how the structures are, their norms, their funding, their value system, their expectations, their knowledge of the land, and their knowledge of the operations. Then from there, we design solutions that now guide conversations within oil and gas.
Thank you very much. And that sounds very exciting. I'm sure we are going to have more engagement on that. And so may I now call upon Mr. Omondi to give us a perspective in terms of what does he think in, that would sort of approach that we can use to bring all the partners together on the table. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for this great forum. For me, I talk more on the side of communities. Communities tend to be not allowed to take, to ask for what is supposed to be theirs. And for me, I have the opinion that, and in all the projects that I participated in, I encourage communities to stand up. I encourage communities, if you have a right to, if you have been promised jobs, if there's anybody starting a project in your area, please stand up for your right. That is what the Constitution says. Stand up for your right. Ask for the jobs. Ask for what was promised in the EIA. Ask for. The chief was very, very diplomatic because she is the chief. But Turkana has already presented in national employment. So let's speak, call a spade a spade.
Yeah.
Turkana should ask for their right for employment in petroleum, whether they have technical know-how or not. Because, and my challenge with a lot of this discourse, and probably that's the reason why somebody asked the issue of honesty behind there, is that honestly, if you don't come to my home, and this I'm paraphrasing an old man in Turkana in 2011, it's never gotten out of my head. You don't come to my home without asking me to come looking for something I don't know, then start passing with your tracks, not saying hi on a daily basis, and expect me to be your friend. It's not possible. So, in EHS, the biggest challenge with EHS is that I had the honor of listening to the three panelists that were there in the last, the three panel sessions that were there. EHS has no community perspective. The law does not allow EHS to deal with specific, with community specific issues. Three quarters of our projects say we are IFC compliant. IFC PS5 says community health and safety. So our EHS has no community angle to it. So let's be honest also. Communities have a right to ask for their right to health, right to employment, right to clean air, right to jobs, right to kukusimamisha. As he says, that small boy at like a twig of a bar and he pass. He has a right to stop you, even violently.
Thank you, Joe. That sounds very exciting, your tips. Now we can call upon Dr. Chumo, so that he can give us the perspective of environmental compliance committee. What do they do, and how do they come on board in terms of putting all partners together in the number of the project on resource management?
Thank you so much, Professor Ngila. I also want to take this opportunity to thank the organizers for giving an opportunity for all of us here to discuss and to have a serious conversation on issues to do with the environment, health, and safety. My name, as you have been told, is Dr. John Kikorif Chumo. I'm the secretary to the National Environmental Complaints Committee. National Environmental Complaints Committee is a government agency for all of us who understands the MCA Act of 1999, there is a creation of four institutions. And those four institutions are, one is the NEMA, which all of us here have been hearing, talking about NEMA, and others. So NEMA, and then we have what we call NEFAN, and then we have National Environmental Tribunal, and then we have what we call National Environmental Complaints Committee. In the past, it used to be called Public Complaints Committee, being created under the EMCA Act from Section 31 to 36. And I want to say this, that environmental National Environmental Complaints Committee is actually the environmental ombudsman. It is actually the advocate of the most of you who have stayed here. Whenever there is an issue that has been raised concerning environmental degradation, when an environment has been polluted, when an environment has been abused, the people you run to is run National Environmental Complaints Committee when the other institutions who are supposed to take care of the environment are failed. So our role is to do investigations, to listen to the complaints, and to also investigate them, and also investigate NEMA, which is the authority. That's what the law says. That whenever they are given work to do, if for example an EIA has been done and it is not proper, it has issues, then you come to us as National Environment Complaints Committee, we can do the investigations, and then after that, we take the report to the Minister in charge of Environment and Forestry for purposes of ensuring that compliance is met. The other thing is that the law also gives us power to take the polluter of the environment to court through what we call public interest litigation. So what we actually say is that this National Environmental Complaints Committee has been there since 2003, since NEMA came on board and others, and we are our issues that we have actually been able to find out are issues to do with pollution of water, solid waste management, issues of forest degradation, issues of public health, and issues of land use. And I think discussing this issue today, especially when we are talking about the issue of environment, health, and safety, these are the issues we get every day in terms of complaints. I think we have had issues with some of those extractive industries, like for example, coal mining around the country, where for example people use very bad chemicals, like for example arsenite or mercury or lead to do the extraction, and they end up actually harming the people. So we, when we get those kind of complaints, we take them to the minister in charge, and we can also take the polluter to court. And I think now going to Turkana, we are now going again. We have even started now receiving complaints on issues to do with the extraction and issues to do with, for example, possible pollution of water sources, for example, and other leakages that may actually arise. And I think as National Environment Complaints Committee, we are going to be more around, for example, in Turkana, because of these kind of issues.
Thank you, Dr. Juma. I really appreciate that. In fact, for the first time, we can hear that we have got our voice, our communities have got voices, because you can walk this office and complain.
Yeah.
And before, we didn't know where to go, so now we know somewhere where to go.
Yes.
Now, for this round of introduction and, of course, brief comments on what each one of the panelists does, now we have reached a level where we can now interact with the delegates. I would like to collect about five questions, and then we see during the conversation how time goes and see whether we can do another list of questions. So now I'm going to be careful about distribution, Okay? So we'll start with that hand there. I'll come here, I'll go to that table. And I think I've got another table, so that is the fifth one. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. All right, so let's start with the gentleman on that side.
Thank you. I'm Joshua Adeo from Seya County. My question goes to Mr. Ekiru. It's very good that you originate from Turkana, and also you are the secretary in the
for the professionals from Turkana. And when Madam Chief was talking to us here, she never mentioned that there is a professional group also which can support her to sensitize the community. So my question to you comes here, as the professionals, what are your inputs into Canada in terms of creating awareness in health and safety, number one. Number two is, okay, as professionals, I think you understand the impact of extraction in that area. So how often do you always engage the investors in that area so that you share with them the need for the community and also to give some light on what they should do to protect the community against any hazards which might occur during their business? Thank you.
Thank you, sir. All right, so
Salim Ali, ni kutoka kwa jamii Kilifi County. Swali la kwanza ni kutaka kujua hiyo professional association kama ilikuwa registered.
Is that a NEC?
No.
Or Tribe 360?
Yes.
Okay.
Imekuwa registered in Kenya ama international. Ingine kuhusu PCC, Public Committee. You know, before the revolution, nilikuwa kwa District Environment Committee, Malindi, which was ranked the best in Kenya, 2 times. And from the community perspective, I was representing the community quite heavily. Now, we've written so many complaints to your office. I don't know whether you are there or not there. But the response zinakuwa delayed sana. Swali ni kwamba nataka kujua how fast tukiandika hizo complaints to you unaweza kuzijibu. Kwa sababu tunajua kuzembea kwa serikali yetu, departments fulani. Tutakupa mfano hai. Unaweza kuingia majambazi kwa duka fulani na community wakazidisha, lakini wakachukua masaa mawili ama matatu kufika pale. Lakini ilitokea incident whereby an Italian red woman alikuwa hitted na kondoo. Tuko barabara kufikiwa hapo. Alienda polisi bio kukuja, yani didn't take even 5 minutes. Lakini roma zima ya
polisi. Tumelewa. Sana salimu. Tumeshukuru sana. There was a press table. Yeah, yes, thank you.
Thank you very much. Mine goes directly to
and the name is
Ombudsman.
Yeah, the name is
Governor's Office of Washington, Council of Authority.
Okay.
Yeah, my first question is goes to Dr. Timu. Mm-hmm. I would like to know his perspective when it comes to the EIS. How does it come? Because most of the issues that we are having are starting from that particular place. Then number two, how do you roll down your services to the committee down there?
Thank you very much. That was short and nice. All right, the fourth person was yourself, and I think there was someone on that side. Yes, please
yes,
proceed.
This comes to the Ombudsman. I wish to ask this Ombudsman, the National Environmental Committee, the Complaints Committee.
Yes, that is Dr. Juma.
Yes.
Yes.
Do they help it, or is it just a PR exercise?
Okay, all right, now we have had that, but they were formed through an act, so that means that they have got powers. But he's going to answer that question. Yes, proceed.
My name is Samuel Omondi. Mm-hmm. My namesake on the panel there, I was a bit concerned with the statement that came towards the tail end of his answer. Even violently.
Is that Joel Omondi, yeah?
Yes,
okay.
Even violently, with respect to, you know, stoppages and blockages that can be placed by any person, you know, who's got a grievance. I think we should not be advocating for violence whenever we have issues or complaints that we need to address. We need to look at the established channels to be able to get those issues resolved. And let's be very careful, you know, the kind of animosity that, you know, a language or a particular speech can find with respect to communities.
Thank you very much, Samo. We have taken note of the concerns. I think the last question, yes, on that table. Yes, proceed.
Hello.
Yes,
mine
sir.
Is just a simple question to the same person. I'm John Fungo.
Mm-hmm.
You talked about the community, and you know, like we have members of parliament, we have members of county assembly, and those representation of the community. You know, when you talk about community, I really find it difficult to understand what you mean, because I look at it from the point like activism.
Yes.
But environment is for all of us all. The constitution talks about that the environment is a responsibility for all of us. We need to find a way how to safeguard it. It's not like, say, you see something wrong and then you're very fast to point a finger, you know. I would like to see how we can
navigate around that. Okay, no, definitely that is well taken. Because that question kind of is, it goes through more or less, almost everybody is affected by that question, and it can be answered by anyone. How do we define community? I remember asking a board, Dr. Melba here, that we have got the national government, we have got the county government, we've got communities. Communities, of course, Kenya is a community. If you look at it from a perspective of the world, Kenya is a community. But then now, I think community, and I stand to be corrected, particularly we've been talking about the local content, that community in this kind of discussion, it is where the resource that has been discovered lies. And so therefore, that resource, we have got a community that is not necessarily the government, which is the county government, then there's the county government, there's the national government. So I would want to, that is the way I understand it, and of course I stand to be corrected, that I would want to interpret that community simply means that, should I say, group of people where that resource is found, and that group of people is not necessarily part of the county government or the national government, because then they become government. But like I said, I stand to be corrected. Now let me go with the first question, and we'll come back to that discussion. So the first question, which was directed to Dr. Ekiru, what are your inputs and what is the impact? I think that was the first question that was asked. Want to go for
yes.
it?
Yes.
The impact of your participation, I think it was the impact of your participation
yes.
with regard to the contract and so forth and so on. Given the background of the information that
let me first, before I delve into that, let me just clarify that being the firstborn amongst the oil exploration areas in Kenya, you know, like every firstborn in a family, you go through a lot of challenges and a lot of responsibilities are bestowed upon you. And I would like to invite my brothers from Nyanza to Turkana. The environment in which we operate in is not ideal, so to say. Back to my question is the impact. Madam Chief, we work very closely. She's a professional, she belongs to our association. And when you hear, when I had her speaking, the first time I ever had her speaking, I actually forgot that she's a government representative.
Okay.
She's an advocate for the community.
All right.
Now, community here, in this context, is the local community that operates within, that lives within the operation area. Because Dr. Melba will agree, in the first Baraza we had definition of community. We have the local community, we have the local community, and then we have the community. There is local, which is around the oil well.
Three locals, yeah.
Then we have the local, which is in the sub county.
Okay.
Then the local, which is the county community. So I think that defines what community is. Our input and our impact. Our input is to do advocacy work, civic education, civic engagement, community engagement, government, and the oil operator engagement. And we cut across issues that affect both the. There are times that we look at the what the community is demanding and we say, look, let's dialogue about this. Is it tenable? Is it reasonable? Isn't this the responsibility of government? For instance, when the community asked for Talo to build a road, it's not Talo's responsibility, it's the government. So we direct the government. When the community said we needed power in Lokichar, we called the PS then, and he made promises and commitment to make sure that the grid from Tankwell gets to Lokichar, where the oil operation is. It took 4 years to get there, but we never stopped to engage. So our impact, we have our association branch in Lokichar, Turkana County, Turkana South Professional Association, which engages on a daily basis. And from the national level, we get feedback and we also give them feedback.
Thank you very much.
The second question was, how often do we engage with investors to protect the community or against hazardous operation? There was last year, hazardous waste was dumped at an unlicensed site. Now, this information got to us at TPA. We went to the site, we engaged with Talo. Now, what Talo did was contract a third party to manage waste management. Now, there was, between NEMA and the Talo and the county government, there was no coordination on how this was going to be managed. And therefore, this contractor just went, found a field and dumped, without knowing that that's where, that's our grazing land, that's our water point, those are our, shrines, and so on. And we were able to bring this to the attention of the national government and NEMA, and there's some work going on, this identification of a site that the county government has provided, and they're working with the national government and NEMA to gazette that area and to, like quarantine that area so that a dumping site can be created and so that animals do not go and graze there.
Thank you. Thank you, David. Thank you very much. I think the next set of questions, it was half question for Trad360. The question was, is it international or is it just local? You could respond to that before I go to the Environmental Complaints Committee.
Trade 360 ni kampuni ambayo iko registered hapa kwa sababu zile shida ambazo ziko ni shida zetu sisi wenyewe. Na ningependa kuongelea mada kuliko kuongelea kampuni yenyewe. Na mambo kuongelea mada ya enhancing partnership between community, industry and government. The earlier session walisema EHS ni it's company driven. But safety is a universal concept. Now, the question becomes, how do you then communicate EHS as a standard to the communities to make sure that they are protected? Now, kwa ile kazi ambayo tumekuwa tukifanya, kuna uwezekano ya kwamba kuna a lot of knowledge gap kutoka kwa industry kwenda kwa community. Yeah? Na ukiangalia hizi community, zile ambazo tunaongelea na nitakupatia example, communicating is not the same. The same way you communicate upper, see the same way you communicate na indigenous na communities ambazo hizi resources ziko huko ndani. Na hiyo ndio mojawapo ya changamoto ambazo kama kampuni ziko nazo when communicating about EHS or creating awareness or defining solutions that the community will then follow up on.
Thank you, Mr. Kaseu, but I've got a half question for you. So, who funds you? Where do you get your money? Because it looks like you are doing community service, where you go to the community to assist with their projects and so forth and so on. But then, how do you get money out of that kind of work?
No, our approach is very simple. Mm-hmm. We design solutions for the industry.
And you look for partnerships.
And we look for partnerships. So okay. I'll give you an example of one program that I'm doing. We're doing in Turkana. Mm-hmm. So there's the issue of beneficiary. How do you give the community benefits that de-risks your operations from the dynamics that the implementation of that project.
I see.
Yeah.
Okay.
So the normal thing that is usually done is we have a CSR department,
okay,
or like KPCD, we form a foundation.
I see.
But then the problem with that, we found out, is that there's no ownership because shule ni yako.
Okay.
Umetengeneza shule ni yako. Kama kuna oil spill, hiyo ni yako. If the community, if a child runs into an oil field, or let's say for example in Turkana, is this, ukienda Turkana sahi, manyata zimefunikwa na EDLP,
okay,
in karatasi,
okay,
ambayo inatumiwa kwa iko na chemicals, ambayo inatumiwa ndani ya well site. How do you sensitize the community itself to know that this is not right material for whatever?
So thank you. Thank
partnerships with the community, yeah, with the commercial partners, because the solutions are for them, assures them social license to operate.
Thank you very much. Definitely, from what I've just heard now, it is very clear that you are actually transacting on behalf of the industry, but with a lot of interest in the community. Thank you very much. Now, the last set of questions I think were directed to us, Dr. Chumo. It is to do with, is this just a rubber stamp? Is it just the next standing for the National Environmental Conflicts Committee? Is it just the name? Do you have teeth? Or you are just there to be paid salary? Can you answer that?
Thank you so much. I think that is very important, and I think I'm happy that the tenants are concerned, because actually that's their taxpayer. They're the taxpayers. Within the law, as I've said, that some of you today would be able to even interrogate the MCA Act and look at the law between the section 31 to 36. And I want to say this, that we are not a peer exercise agency. But we have teeth, because one is that we can be able to take what to court, and we can actually pin somebody to ensure an institution to ensure that correction is actually done. So I think to me, we have done it before, and I think we are able to do it even in future.
And how quickly do you respond?
So the other thing is about how fast it is. Our charter is very clear that as soon as we receive the complaint, we shall be able to respond accordingly. But the report will be out within 1 month, so that people can be able to, the issues can be addressed. Because I want to tell you that, if you're talking about investigation, you can't get a complaint today, and then within a week, you have answers. But you have, within 1 month, you shall be able to get all the things that are required. And we have done that. And the only thing now is that once we have actually given the report, it's actually another institution that's supposed to implement. But in all what we do, once that institution doesn't even implement, we come in through what we call public interest litigation and take the person to court or the institution to court. The other thing is about how feasible are we on the ground. One is that if you look at the law, it only created us at the national level. But we are now working on it to ensure that we come to the, with the respect to the devolution, that every county shall be able to have an officer. But at the moment, we are using the ombudsman. I mean, we are using the office of the ombudsman at the county, mm-hmm, and also at the Duma Center, and also the office of ESCC, Ethics and Corruption Commission. But moving forward, soon we shall be able to have officers at the ground. But I want to say this, that I want to give you a number, which is actually called the
office. Okay, let's take down the number.
Yes.
The number is 0722.
0722 510 510 510 0722 510 510. So 722 510 510 510 722, you can't forget that one. Now thank you so much, my panelists, and a lot of pressure because everybody traffic bus is here, and so there, because of that, you can see that I'm a Rakishan in them, even before they finish the words. I really do apologize for that, Hari. Yes?
Can I just want...
Oh, you want to respond to the allegation?
Yes.
I think you were saved.
No, I was not saved.
Okay.
I think it is important that we identify the
context. Together in 30 seconds.
We identify the context that we are in. In Turkana, everybody protects his assets, his or her assets, using weapons of violence. That's different from what
that is the culture. We have to understand the context of the culture.
In Turkana, Kano themselves protect their assets using weapons of violence. They have security people who walk with their trucks. They have security people in camps. That is a standard in all oil operations. Now, Turkanas protect their, how many Turkanas are here? Protect their livestock using weapons of violence. So that's the context we are talking about. You're not talking about the context in Nairobi. The context in Nairobi is different. And when the Baraza goes to the ground, then that discussion comes up a little bit more within the context that probably that will be answered better.
Thank you so much, Jen. I really appreciate. Bernice, David, I'm just closing them. Mr. Kaseu, Mr. Omondi, and Dr. Chumo, thank you so much. Pressure. Madam is standing here. Doctor is once me out, so we really appreciate. And we also appreciate the delegates. I know that you didn't have an opportunity to do it the long way. Yeah. But all the same, I think we have had 2 days, long, 2 short days, so to speak, because it was very exciting. And thank you so much to the host, Extractives Baraza. We can't do without you. Thank you.
Yes, I know the conversation is getting hotter, but it's 4:30 p.m. We need to start winding up. Thank you. This is wonderful, panelists, as they're making their way across the state, the academics end of individual 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Namayo. So thank you so much to all our wonderful panelists the whole day and the fantastic moderators who've taken us through the sessions. Now, as we are closing, allow me to call upon, you know, there's been an organization here which has been mentioned adversely over and over again, NEMA. Dr. John, kindly, I think it's only fair that we give them a chance. The first question, in fact, everybody wants to know, where were you in 2010? That is what the chief posed. So, but kindly, if you can just respond in 5 minutes and also in closing. Thank you.
Okay. I'll just be on the spot. There was a question that was asked about local capacity. We, as members, we have taken part in building the capacity of Turkana County. And I can attest, I think even Kimwene can attest that we've trained quite a number of officers, I think 20 officers, in the fields of conflict resolution and grievance mechanism, environmental social impact assessment, understanding land acquisition. And you can also hear from the panel there, they even attested to themselves that there's some work that the work that NEMA is doing on the ground, contrary to what was being said earlier. And with regard to another question that was being said about the issue of following up the conditions of the licensing. What happens is that this licensing is done based on a mandated by the sectoral way. It is not NEMA alone that does it. We work in collaboration of Ministry of Energy, Kenya Wildlife Services, WARMA, and there are quite a number of tools that have also been developed to that effect. There's the gender assessment. We are working on coming up with environmental and social impact assessment guidelines. We're also coming up with the health impact assessment. There's quite a number of things that maybe in another context can be explained. So, in a nutshell, I'll let me stop at that, and then I give my project.
Eric, if it's not working, you're more than welcome to come to this podium.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, delegates, and thank you very much, Akhtari, for allowing us to spend time with you since is it Monday? But what we want to say is this, that extractives by nature have an impact on the environment. So we can't run away from that. And those impacts not only affect the environment, but also on the health and safety of the people. So it is important to look at different tools that we can use to manage those impacts as time as a result of the extractives. The extractive Baraza has had similar functions before. The first one discussed revenue sharing. We looked at local content. Today, we have been looking at environmental health and safety. There is need to link all these discussions because some of the issues that are coming out here in terms of revenue, in terms of access to resources and the health and environmental matters then need to find room and be able to link with all those areas. As an authority, and we have been told from yesterday, that there are different ways of looking at these things. One, looking at the legal and prosecution levels, looking at issues of compliance assistance, and where necessary, looking at issues of incentives to those who are complying with the regulations. As an authority, I can tell you or assure you that we are looking at all those areas. And as my colleague has mentioned, we're looking at it from a multi-stakeholder approach, where we have different people with different mandates coming together to be able to tackle some of these things. In that way, we'll be able to achieve some degree and level of achievement and sustainability for that matter. So we take these extractive barazas seriously ourselves, and we look forward to the proceedings of these barazas so that we can see what it is that the authority has to take up and be able to respond to some of those issues. And on behalf of the Director General and all NEMA fraternity, we'd like to thank Daktari and the Extractive Baraza team for organizing this forum, because they help us to get to understand the concerns that the public has, and it is out of that then we are able to develop appropriate tools, appropriate mechanisms, and strategies to be able to address the issues that we are talking about. We know that there are emerging issues, and as we develop and review these tools that we have, we'll be able to take on board some of those emerging issues and be able to have a much more comprehensive framework that we need to put in place to be able to address the environmental matters in this country. The environment is for us all. It is our responsibility as government and the public and private sector to take our roles in respecting but also taking care of the environment for now and future generations. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. I think NEMA once and for all has dispelled the rumor that they are not available. It is now officially a very bad rumor. The truth is NEMA is absolutely available, and that has been proven by the fact that we've been here with us. This is day three for them. On Monday, we had an exclusive invite-only government function so that they can talk to each other. NEMA was there too. And so they've been with us. Now, as we are winding up, I'd like to invite our Ogao, because he came in as key expert for this, and although we cut short his presentation, I think it's absolutely imperative in the true Kenyan spirit, you don't bring visitors. You just don't tell them kwaheri tutaonana from the door. You know, you have to give them a chance to come and say thank you and, you know, all of that. So, Oga, kindly. And tell us if there's any opportunities to come and visit the Niger Delta.
Thank you very much. It's fantastic. Okay, so, you know, I cut my talk yesterday because we had some session. So, I'll try and wrap this up in 5-7 minutes. So, first and foremost, I want to absolutely appreciate everyone in the room, especially Baraza, NEMA, and the management of the forum, because it's an absolute pleasure to have been here and to have sat down in the audience participated, but also experienced what it felt like for Nigerians who have gone through this. Things are a little better. So yesterday morning, a gentleman woke up, stood up in the back, a gentleman from, I think it's a research sense for concern. Concerned scientist.
Oh,
yeah. Yeah. That's the one. So he made a comment yesterday and he said, in Nigeria, it's the oil and gas sector in Nigeria has become a curse. And then he hopes that Kenya don't go the same route. So as I would, I wrote a post on LinkedIn, okay? And I quoted that comment. And for me, it was trying to express the fact that it's a great opportunity to learn from other people's mistakes. But interestingly, not many Nigerians like the comment. So between yesterday and today, that post has been viewed by over 4,000 people.
Wow.
Okay? And with lots of comments. Someone like, is it not shameful that Nigeria has become a case in point? And others were like, well, if others can learn from us, so be it. Now, I happen to stand in the category of folks who believe that if others can learn from Nigeria, why not? That's because I'm an African. So may I happily and appreciate you for making me your professional guinea pig for the last 2 days. So in that note, I'd like you to clap for me. I can assure you it hasn't been easy being a guinea pig, but it's good. Now, we understood and we clarified the dynamics of industry, academic governance, and NGOs around the knowledge, power, money, and rights dynamics. I want to make a point. Nobody on its own is complete. You are not complete in a bubble. You are possibly sufficient, but you cannot be proficient. And neither can you be efficient. I'll say it again. None of you in your different bubble is complete. You might be sufficient, but you can never be proficient. And you can definitely never be efficient. It's the reason why NGOs are very enthusiastic. It's all about the rights. But in the enthusiasm, they lack the knowledge why some things just don't work the way they think it should. NGO wants to start making money from next week. But without the knowledge from academia, that maturation time for revenue in the oil and gas sector minimum is 10 years. So you are screaming in anger because you want to fight your rights, but you lack the knowledge of practicality and reality. And so fundamentally, for you to be complete, you need to partner with the other party in the room. So NGO needs some knowledge. NGOs need some money. But they've showed us already how much money they need. They want to increase from 5% to 10%. Okay? Just the same way academia needs money. Academia needs understanding push rights. So for compromise to happen, you cannot operate in a bubble. Now, the next point is this. Never make a mistake to think the reason you are here is critically and only for Kenya. That will be the biggest mistake we make in this world. Whatever you're doing here has got the propensity to impact the East African space and potentially the African space. Let me give an example. Our projects where a country under a local content policy sponsor and pay a lot of money to train locals in welding. And I'm referring to the gentleman from NEMA who just trained 20 professionals in communities. And after they spent so much money, they trained them, they came back. For one reason or the other, the oil and gas operation was shut down. The training became a crisis. Because now they are trained, there's nowhere to work. And that is because if they have realized that in the training, the incorporation of the potential for the utilization of the skills in other sectors that are synergistic impacts on the design and delivery of the training. So that means fundamentally, you should realize that not only is there a geographical spread to what you're doing here, there's also a subject matter and multi-sectoral spread. It's absolutely vital in whatever you do
because the oil and gas sector is not in isolation. Currently, I'm consulting for Tanzania with developing local content in the agricultural sector. And the funny thing is that at the time I was consulting for them to develop local content in the oil and gas sector, I told them to increase the scope to other sectors. They said I was getting too much. Now I'm starting to realize, oh my goodness, we are diverting towards agriculture, and local content works in oil and gas, so it should work in agriculture. Now they're calling me back again to come and say, well, I think you told us, now we're interested. It's my point. Very important. It's multi-geographical and it's multi-sectoral. Now, I think you should clap for Nema for this. They've had too much hassle since yesterday. Okay? I love it when the gentleman stood here just a few minutes ago and said that Nema is now beginning to articulate how their policy should be framed around compensation, penalties, and a support system. I think it's the best way to go for policy implementation in Africa. I've done lots of work and models around this, and so I'd like to have a conversation with you guys afterwards, because I think that is how you can break it through. Now, finally, I would hate myself if I don't say this. This is the very final part. As an environmentalist, I sat in the room all through yesterday and today, and I discovered something. All the focus in environment through yesterday and today has been on output, on waste, the output of a process, waste. No single person ever mentioned input. Environmental sustainability is not about mitigating your output. It's equally about reducing your input in the first place. Because if you reduce your input, automatically your waste is reduced. How much energy do you use? How much water do you use? Your input in the system impacts on your output. There is so much focus on waste and air pollution, but what went into the system? So as an environmentalist, it's a fatal flaw that is only concentration and focus on the output. For true sustainability in the environment, you have to consider the input, the process, and the output. Absolutely important. And I want to paint that picture in a sense. You cannot overemphasize the importance of knowledge, which is why research becomes fundamental. I had a conversation. I was consulted by Lagos State Government. I was to actually design their climate change summit. The last 6 years, Lagos State Government has been holding the largest conference on climate change, probably in West Africa. Over 1,020 people gathered in a room for 4 days. So when I was consulted, I quickly realized that, wait a minute, for the last 4 years or 6 years, each time they had a conference, they always invited government people to come and give, you know, their long government talks. I'm like, wait a minute, it doesn't make any sense. How can Lagos State be the biggest state with the largest conglomeration of sector, private sector, in probably in Africa, and you haven't invited private sector folks to any of your conferences on matters of environment? So that year, I was charged to invite top executives. Let me paint a picture of a conversation I had with a COO of a top bank in Nigeria. So I met this man. He said, okay, well, can I invite just a speaker at a conference? And he was like, what conference is it? I said, it's on climate change. I said, don't talk to me. Go and talk to Shell and Chevron, that it was polluting the environment. That really pissed me off, but I was going to be nice to the gentleman. Obviously, I'm much younger, so there's also the issue of respect. So I said, sorry, sir, can I ask you a few questions? He said, go ahead. I said, as a bank, how many branches do you have? He said, 400 branches. What do I mean branches? I mean like full one-story building. 400 branches. And I said, how many staff do you have? He said, over 12,000 staff. I said, no. I said, your staff members, might they have cars? And he goes, oh yeah, at least half of my staff, because you know bankers are high paid. At least half of the staff would have cars. Then I said, how many generators do you have in your 400 branches? He mentioned 2 mega KVA, some capacity. These generators per branch. I said, how many ATMs might you have? He sell over 60,000 ATMs in a particular region.
Interesting.
And I was like, what powers your ATM? Say diesel generators. And I said, in your staff houses, might they have generators? If you know Nigeria and the power situation is a mess. I said, might they have generators? At this point, he said, Doc, why are you asking me all these questions? Are you a journalist? And I said, I'm trying to show to you that as a bank, you are worse than Shell, Chevron, Mobil put together in terms of environmental footprint. I was shocked. I sat back in the room about 20 minutes ago. Yeah, bear me witness, believe in the back. And together, we did a quick count of how many bottles of water we used in this room in the last 2 days. Do you know how many?
Yeah.
1,300. Ask her, we can get it together. Wow. Do the estimate. 170 people estimate one day. Second day, 160. And we have 4 rounds of water bottle share per day. It's simple mathematics. 1,320 bottles in 2 days. In a conference to talk about environment? So if I was to estimate the environmental footprint of the conference on environment is probably worse than what different companies who you see the project as the real polluters have done. So it's either you want to do this or you don't. In wrapping up, a company, let me stress, saved $40,000. Guess how? By simply eliminating bottled water at corporate meetings. In 1 year, $40,000. I don't mean general meetings, just the senior management, corporate meetings. The Bank of America saved $500,000 by reducing the weight of their ATM receipts from 20 pounds to 15 pounds. It's the same receipt, the print on it is the same. But just by reducing the weight from 30 pounds to, from 20 pounds to 15 pounds, they save $500,000. There is a business case to being sustainable. In conclusion, this issue you're talking about for me is just beyond the conference. I travel too much to know this is big. I'm too passionate about this, so I don't mess around. That's the honest truth. Africa is in a crisis. Did you know that air quality is the fourth largest contributor of deaths in the world? WHO records that every year in Africa alone, 700,000 people die from issues related to air quality. Let me give you what that means. It means air quality alone is tantamount to death from HIV/AIDS and double to death from malaria. But you know the funny thing? You never see air pollution. Silent killer, thank God. Kenya is at a point in its history where there's a potential for massive transformation to impact the continent. And I am happy to be that chair. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Akin. And to clarify, Strathmore will recycle all these water bottles. And now we close. It's been a long 2 days, but a wonderful 2 days. Can we agree? Can we start by appreciating the wonderful team, the staff that has put this together? Usually at the end, I think we should start at the beginning. Because big conferences like this don't run as seamlessly as this one has, okay? I'd like, at this point in time, if there's any staff of the Extractives Baraza in the room, kindly stand up. What do you notice about them? Hard working. Those who are looking for wives, I don't know. but they're also young. Very well, very young. This, ladies and gentlemen, has been the effort of many months, and Laura Muniafu, standing right there by the door, has been leading the effort and the team. Through writing of the technical paper, through most of you have gotten all the invitations from Laura. She's facilitated you. She's not done it alone though. She's had the help of these individuals as well as the others back at the office. The Extractives Baraza team is absolutely amazing, and none of this would have happened but for them. So asante sana. Thank you. Then of course I've got to thank my boss. Strathmore Dean, on behalf of Strathmore, thank you so much. But the Strathmore University staff, in the fraternity, I'd like to thank all the panelists and all the moderators. It's not easy to moderate a session, especially when you've got such a vibrant audience. I'd like to thank everybody who made a presentation, all the companies, the government entities, the NGOs present, and of course, academia, as we've heard. And of course, ladies and gentlemen, can we give a special round of applause for the citizens? It is absolutely critical that these conversations don't just stay with us or in the sector, isn't it? Because we are all Kenyans, and for people to come out of their busy days just to come and listen and gain knowledge, what an amazing thing to have happened. So for us, as we close off, we'd like to say a heartfelt thank you. On my own behalf, it's been an absolute honor and a privilege to have been your MC on and off for the last 2 days. And I look forward to more Barazas. Nataka mimi kwenda to plan out to sit under the trees. The rivers when they've dried, to have those nice Barazas. I want to sit under the trees. I want to go sit in Kwale under the mango trees where the president said to Nagoja to the mangoes. The first president told us, mango to Nagoja to the mangoes to fall as custodians. But, Ninazi, not mangoes. Lakini ni sawa pia. Mazungumzo lazima yafanyike, si ndio? So I'm looking forward to take the Extractives Baraza mashinani. We are looking forward to your partnerships. When you write to you, please let us stay in touch. So from now on, I hope those who are looking for wives have at least identified a potential or two. Make sure, my brother, that now is the time to leverage. Work your phone, a joke, Turkana, my friend, all eyes on Turkana, 5% is coming in a very big way. So, ladies and gentlemen, and a big thank you to each and every one of you. Those of you who travel from so far, Lamu is not close. You have to take a mini, you know, it's not anywhere else. Turkana is not close. And all these other counties, asante sana, we hope you've had a knowledgeable time with us, a wonderful time. We will be in touch. Asante.
Thank you so much.
Sorry, the last thing. One lady has told me, and I like this, she requested the following. She said there are people who had follow-up questions, and they didn't get to answer those, to get answers to their questions. If you had any questions targeted at anybody or in general, please send them to us. We will compile them and we will send them to the relevant people, and then they'll get in touch with you. So, as I tell you.